On this episode of Doing the Most, we're in part four of our series, So Ya Wanna Brew.
Homemade brews and various artus, everything from meat to roast, bake creation, fermentation, inebriation, doing the most.
Fermentation is as complex as it is rudimentary. Getting started can feel like a complete whirlwind from the first moment you type it in the search bar. How to make beer at home. A lot of folks come to our YouTube channel looking for information on how to make wine or mead. And while we put a lot of effort and thought into how to show the brewing process step by step, we could tell that more could be done to break everything down to the nuts and bolts. We really wanted to strive for an introductory course to fermentation. That's where this series began. You may want to check out the first three videos in this series on homebrewing equipment, microorganisms, and the fermentation process itself. In this episode, though, we're talking about bottling. Real quick, let's check out the ground rules we set at the beginning. This channel is more focused on wines and meads than beers, but the majority of what is presented in this guide will also be relevant when making beer. However, to simplify our language, must will be used throughout instead of wort. Also, most folks don't consider meads or wines to be brewed. That's fine, but we're going to lump all home fermentations of alcoholic beverages into the homebrew category. This will include referring to fermentations that have completed primary as brews. Once fermentation is complete and your brew is ready to drink, you'll need to get it packaged up for consumption. While some homebrewers like to put their products into kegs, we will be discussing bottling only. Bottling is how the majority of beginner homebrewers package their brews, and if you're just starting out, most likely you will too. Bottling works just like racking, except with an added piece of equipment, the bottling wand. The bottling wand is a valve contraption that gives you control over how the fermented brew gets from the carboy to the bottles. The bottling wand attaches to the end of the racking system via your tubing and has a valve at the end. When the valve is pressed against the bottom of the bottle, it opens up and your brew flows into the bottle from the bottom up. You lift when the bottle is full and move on to the next bottle. When you remove the wand from the bottle, there should be appropriate headspace remaining for corking. However, for a brew that will be capped and carbonated in the bottle, you'll want to leave a little bit more breathing room by lifting up when the liquid is an inch or so from the mouth of the bottle. There are two common ways of sealing the bottles, corking and capping. Corking is exactly what it sounds like, putting a cork into a bottle. As per best practices, sanitize your corks prior to use. For corked bottles, you will want to use bottles made for corking. This means no screw top bottles. This will most often be 750ml or 1L wine bottles, and those will most often be sized for number 8 or number 9 corks. You can use natural or synthetic corks, but most advanced winemakers will advocate for natural corks because they're said to provide better micro-oxygenation for wines. However, they are more expensive. Using a bottle not made for corking, like a screw-top bottle, can have catastrophic effects. Don't do it. Also, do not cork carbonated beverages. A cork will be at risk of being pushed out the bottle, or even worse, a bottle not rated for pressure can dangerously explode. Corkers come in two types, floor corkers and hand corkers. Both perform the same function. A thin plunger pushes the sanitized cork into the bottle. A floor corker is typically more expensive, but provides better, more steady control. A hand corker is preferred by most due to its simplicity and how easy it is to store. However, it does require a steadier hand and sometimes a good set of knees. Once bottles are corked, they should spend a few days upright and the rest of their days on their side. This will prevent the cork from drying out and crumbling or cracking. Capping is a whole other ballgame, and again, there are a couple of options, hand cappers and bench cappers. Hand cappers are similar to hand corkers. A magnet holds onto the cap while you place the bell on top of the bottle. With a little bit of pressure, the arms go down and the cap is crimped closed. The bench capper is typically bolted down to a workbench for stability. The bottle is placed under the height-adjustable bell and the arm is pressed down to cap the bottle. There is another alternative as well. Swing tops. Swing tops use the force of pressure to hold a rubber or silicon gasket against the mouth of the bottle. For drinks that will be consumed soon, like eggnog or summer wines, these can be a great reusable option. Okay, still versus sparkling. Bottling still brews, that is, non-carbonated brews, is fairly straightforward. The biggest concern is minimizing oxygen exposure. Sparkling or carbonated brews are another beast entirely. Extra work must be done to ensure your sparkling brews do, in fact, sparkle. When not using a kegging system, two elements should remain in mind: priming sugars and PSI. This video can't even begin to scratch the surface on the variety of priming sugars and methods of calculating how they will affect your final product. Our foremost recommendation is to Google priming sugar calculator and input your own variables. What you're after is the appropriate carbonation level for the style of beer, wine, or mead you've fermented. Again, search engines are your friend when determining how to carbonate the product you've created. The most common priming sugar is typically dextrose. Corn sugar, 3.5 to 5 ounces, is usually used for a 5-gallon batch. And remember, your brew should not be stabilized if you want your yeast to be able to ferment your priming sugars and carbonate your bottles. The process is simple. Mix the appropriate amount of priming sugar with a cup of warm, sterile water and pour it into the bottling bucket. Then rack on top of it, using the whirlpool of the racking tube to mix the priming sugar evenly throughout the batch. Then bottle away. Give your bottled brews 3 to 4 weeks alone to condition. If you've bottled still wine or mead, this 3 to 4 weeks helps prevent bottle shock, a condition where freshly bottled wine tastes flat and flabby. Bottle shock isn't well understood by current science, but what seems clear to most everyone is a little bit of time reverses the condition. So once you've bottled, be willing to wait a month or two before consumption. And just some reminders for storage. Capped bottles should be stored upright. For bottle-conditioned brews, this allows the remaining film of yeast to settle at the bottom. Corked bottles should be stored on their sides after a few days so that their corks stay wet. Well, that's it for the fourth and final part of So You Wanna Brew. Now we turn to you. What'd we miss? Let us know in the comments. We're always looking for more ways to help inform and educate those who really want to do the most. You can find us on Instagram and Pinterest at doingthemostokay, and check out our website at doingthemost.org. To stay tuned for our adventures, hit that subscribe button so you won't miss anything. Thanks for watching. See you next time.